One of the most fascinating aspects of Portuguese Jewish history is the story of the Jews of Belmonte, which is absolutely fascinating. And really, it's especially interesting because it is a continuous history that is still developing, and it's quite exciting. A lot of the Jewish history that we have today is centered in really important cities like Lisbon, and especially the beautiful Porto. But Belmonte has a very special story that we really got to look at. So here's a map show you roughly where Belmonte is. It's a small village just a little bit south of Douro River, not too far from the university at Coimbra. And here's a beautiful picture, by the way, from last time I was there. You can see that it's very rustic, and you've got the mountains fading away into the distance, lots of cobblestone streets, really a fascinating kind of hilltop village. But the story that connects to the Jews is absolutely fascinating because, you see, what happened is, after the forced conversion of Jews in 1497, that effectively ended the presence of practicing Jews in Portugal, there were a number of Jews who went underground. As we've discussed in previous videos, these crypto-Jews, also known as New Christians, that's what they were called by the Christian community, or the conversos, were also known as Marranos. The term Marranos has fallen into disfavor because it is a derogatory term, means swine, and obviously was connected with the idea that these new Christians who were forcibly converted and their descendants were somehow still returning to Judaism. In reality, we see that in certain communities, like in Belmonte, that is precisely what was happening. One of the more preferred terms today is Bnei Anusim, or simply Anusim, which means the children of those who were forced, or simply the forced, because they were forced to accept Christianity at the end of the 15th century, although they obviously rejected it. At any rate, what happened in Belmonte was that there were Jews there who simply went underground. To the outside world, they portrayed themselves as Christians, which is essentially the crypto-Jewish story, but they maintained their continuity for five centuries. Now, they have some lingering issues that are associated with that, such as, for example, some genetic ailments because of consistent intermarriage. And in terms of traditional Judaism, we have to understand that they've been separated from the larger population of Jews for half a millennium, so quite a bit of their Jewish observance has kind of been shaped by that. Some holidays actually got a lot more attention, like, for example, the fast of Esther, which is a kind of a minor fast in the rest of the Jewish world. For crypto Jews is especially important because Esther herself, in the book of Esther, is described as perhaps the first crypto Jew because she had to present herself as a non-Jew in order to survive personally, and later she revealed herself and, of course, saved the Jewish people as a whole. At any rate, so they have an attenuated type of Judaism in many ways because of this 500-year separation from the Jewish world. But in the 20th century, they have engaged much more deeply, and of course, they have some fascinating things. First of all, let's talk about the story of their discovery, which is just amazing as well. A man named Samuel Schwartz, who was a Jew from Eastern Europe, who was an engineer working in the region. And he, you know, spoke multiple languages, was an autodidact, very interested in history and things like that. And it happened that in 1917, he was working in the region in some mines. And, you know, he was doing various things. And someone said to him, "Whatever you do, don't do business with Baltazar Pereira de Sousa." Why? Because they said he's actually a Jew. So anyway, Schwartz thought, why would you think there's a Jew here in the middle of rural Portugal? But he decided to check it out a little bit, and turns out he uncovered this crypto-Jewish community. They were quite suspicious of him at first. I bet they said to him, "Funny, you don't look Jewish." But at any rate, when he insisted on speaking with them more about this, and then he started reciting for them certain things like the Shema Yisrael prayer, they actually believed him, and they said, "Okay, I guess we can open up." This is, after all, the beginning of the 20th century, and the Inquisition, although it lasted for 400 years, is officially over at this point, so they gradually opened up to Schwartz, and he discovered this existence of a phenomenal crypto-Jewish community still active in Portugal. He wrote up his findings in several publications, which attracted worldwide attention. A lot of historians and scholars descended on the community to try to understand them better, and it's absolutely fascinating. Here's a look at the community again today. Here's the beautiful synagogue that was built there for the Crypto Jews of Belmonte, and here's the interior with the ark. It's absolutely gorgeous, really powerful statement. You can imagine praying in this beautiful space after being hidden for 500 years. Here's the mikveh, very beautiful. And they have an excellent museum there, which unfortunately doesn't have a lot of stuff online. We really got to see more of this because it is gorgeous. They have all kinds of interesting artifacts related to the crypto-Jewish practice, like this interesting funnel-like device, which was apparently designed to allow women to light candles on Friday nights and to hide the glow from neighbors who might be looking in the windows. And women were especially prominent in preserving the traditions under these really horrific conditions. We see this not only from Esther mentioned earlier, but really in the crypto-Jewish communities throughout Latin America and the Iberian Peninsula. And I can't wait to get back to Belmonte this October, God willing, when the COVID restrictions subside and we'll be able to travel again. I'm looking forward to seeing it and spending a lot more time in that amazing museum. Thank you very much for watching.